This is a Red FM Vancouver podcast. Make sure you hit subscribe for more great content. For further info, log on to redfm.ca.
Thank you, Mr. Chiu, to join us today. So tell us a little bit about this information that Chinese Canadians are telling us, that the Chinese government is trying to and successfully controlling Chinese people here and threatening them. And there is a penetration of Chinese government in Richmond particularly. Is there something happening of this nature?
Well, sir, first of all, thank you, Harjinder, for having me here. We as Canadians are gravely concerned about foreign interference. And we know that Canada is a peaceful country. It's a middle power. And because of that, perhaps, Canada is also the battleground for many foreign governments trying to interfere with our country. And we know that, for example, over 10 years ago, Richard Fadden, the former CSIS director, has already warned us that several players, you know, Russians, Chinese, and other players, Indians were actually, the Indian government were actually also cited as well. They are actually actively involved with industrial espionage and all that. However, we know also that, you know, particularly aggressive in recent years, it's the Chinese Communist Party, the CCP, and this government has actually a department called United Front Work Department, and the mission of this department is to actually start influencing overseas diaspora communities, Chinese in Greater Vancouver, Toronto, and you know, New York, London, you name it.
Is the United Front are the spy agency of the Chinese government?
It belongs to their infrastructure, and it doesn't matter whether they're spy or not, officially classified. Their mission is actually to influence the diaspora, like you and I. Mm-hmm. Of course, you're not regarded as Chinese. Their target is more to ethnic Chinese population. We found there have been reports in Australia and other countries that are very concerning. The difference is in Canada, we have very few legislature that is actually protecting our country's interests.
Mr. Chiu, the main concern was that if somebody of Chinese origin here in Vancouver in Canada involved into the anti-Chinese protests and stuff, then they will arrest their kith and kin, their relatives in China, or they will bother them to make their life difficult. Is it correct?
There has been numerous reports of that practice, yes. People who have relative connections in China, their relatives would be contacted, their parents, their father, mothers, and their business interests will actually be affected. Yes, that is actually correct. There has been report.
So when you compare it with India-China relationship, considering now, so are they doing the same thing? Do you have reports of that?
No, the only thing I can actually cite is about a month ago, the skirmishes between India and China near the Kashmir border area that actually caused, you know, just on the Indian side, 20 soldiers were killed. And that's the only part that we can actually cite right now. But having said that, it's not unusual for countries to use or weaponize nationalism in the times of their challenge. When their government is in trouble, it's being challenged, they will actually erect issues that rally up the nationalism.
Somehow the United Front is depicting or kind of influencing here the latest India-China confrontation or tensions?
Yes, I think many Canadians are now coming to terms with how vulnerable our country, Canada, is, and they are waking up to you know, having more protection of our country. In fact, just today there was a news report on Globe and Mail that over 50% of Canadians now believe that there has to be some sanction against China's aggressive behaviors in Canada.
That's interesting. So what is the impact of the security law passed in Hong Kong? Somehow it'll impact Canadian Chinese?
Yes. The national security law, it's unlike any of ours, in Canada. I'm an opposition MP. My mission is to demonstrate to Canadians that we are here having a better idea of governing Canada, and therefore we want to unseat the governing party, which is the Liberal Party of Canada. Such is not tolerated in Hong Kong's national law. And not only that, you would think that the law is only applicable to residents of Hong Kong. Unfortunately, according to their Article 38, for example, you and I, by any evidence that show that you and I have committed, according to them, any action against the central government in China, even when we are overseas, even when you and I don't belong to Hong Kong or resident there, are subject to them. And that's probably why Prime Minister Trudeau had actually enacted a defensive action in suspending the extradition treaty with Hong Kong, because otherwise, if you say something bad on air, Harjinder, for example, if you criticize them too much, they may actually ask for your extradition to Hong Kong, and through that, you could be actually tried anywhere in China. So I support the government's defensive action. However, time has run out now for the defensive action. We now need to look at what needs to be done proactively to safeguard and control the situation.
Well, I want to make it clear, if as a Canadian citizen who has who was born in India, if I participate in any kind of protest here in Vancouver, my Indian government doesn't bother me. But if a Chinese person participates in an agitation or some kind of demonstration here against China, would they be immediately silenced, or United Front people will just start circling their wagons around their house, or what will happen?
Well, yes and yes and yes. The issue here is that they have a list of crimes that you could commit under the national security law just imposed on Hong Kong. And according to that list of crimes, if you actually commit to any of them, then you'll be guilty, you'll be charged, you could be charged, even if you are first overseas, and secondly, even if your citizenship is Canadian or of Indian South Asian descent. Yes, so they could request for an extradition of this particular person if they wanted to. But thankfully, the government has now suspended the extradition treaty. And unfortunately, to me, that's unfortunately it's throwing out the baby with the bathwater situation, because extradition law between two places identify the two places' systems are compatible. In this case, it's the British common law system between Canada and Hong Kong. We have to shut it down now in order to protect our citizens.
Are you in favor of Canadian government passing a law like UK that Canadians stuck in Hong Kong now, they can come and live here in Canada?
The law that is being considered in UK, it's applicable to those who were born before 1997, when Hong Kong was actually returned to China.
Mm-hmm.
What we know is in the past year and a half particularly, during a lot of protests, over 9,000 people were arrested in Hong Kong, and about one-third of them were students. And these students, definitely they would be born after 1997.
Mm-hmm.
So what I'm advocating in with the government right now, it's you know, if there is any way that we could actually provide a lifeboat scheme that could actually help these young activists, perhaps Canada could actually offer them educational paternity for them to actually learn about what true democracy is practiced, you know, our argument, what we can and cannot do. You know, we don't have a perfect democracy in Canada, but at the same time, we could actually learn from the past and then improve ourselves. So I think all these are great lessons that, you know, young people that were born after 1997 in Hong Kong could have learned if they seek support from Canada.
Mm-hmm. Tell me, how can China-Canada relationship be improved? Leaving Mengwan Zhu or trading Mengwan Zhu for two Michaels, do you think they'll fix the problem?
Well, no, unfortunately. You know, using hostage diplomacy is actually something that many countries, developed countries, countries that have respect and stature in the world, no longer practice. And this is what my wish list for China is, I guess. China today, it's not the China in the 20th century. We know that China is stronger now, but with strength. With power comes responsibility. And as China now has a bigger clout in influencing the world, my hope for China is that they will be able to learn how to abide to and agree with the core values in the world, respect for human rights, and how to live peacefully and how to abide to international laws. Mengwan Zhou, for example, it's an extradition treaty that you know, Canada has commitment to, and therefore, especially with the Liberal Trudeau government violated ethics law in the SNC-Lavalin situation, they cannot afford to be seen as interfering with justice again. So, China needs to understand that and needs to work with the world on that. Having hostages like our two Michaels will actually worsen their image around the world and therefore giving them more difficulty in the coming future.
Michael Chiu, thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you, Harjinder, for having me.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to another Red FM podcast. Don't forget to hit subscribe and check out our Red FM Canada YouTube channel. For further info, log on to our Red FM social media platforms or visit redfm.ca.